When it comes to competitive drifting, we've seen the power levels rise year after year. However, power isn't everything in a professional drift car, and grip is just as important in order to get speed. We're here with James Deane, who is no stranger to professional drifting, having won the European Drift Championship 6 times, the Irish Drift Championship 5 times, and Formula D in the US for the last 2 seasons. Now, James is more familiar to the Nissan S-Chassis, and he's got a relatively fresh build behind us, a BMW E92. And my first question, James, is why that change when you're so familiar with that Nissan S-Chassis? You've probably got that pretty dialed in, you know it back to front, and why make such a dramatic change to a completely new chassis?
Yeah, so for me, I've been pretty much competing in the Nissan S-Chassis for almost 10 years, and we know this car inside out. We know its strong points, its weak points, and to be honest, for me, I wanted to try something new. And just going back to competitive drifting, as you said, grip is a huge thing. The biggest downfall with the S-Chassis, I think, is forward grip, but it's probably the best overall car. You can just sit in, drive, it's nimble, it reacts just the way you want it to, but you can see a lot of the more modern chassis just have that bit more forward grip. So that was a big part of it for me. We decided to go with this E92 because the rear suspension setup is a lot different. It has quite a lot more mechanical grip. Chris Stapps from HEK Racing in Latvia, they actually build these chassis, and he was competing in Formula Drift in the US for the last 2 years, and his car was probably the fastest car in track. So I was watching his car and thinking, man, if I ever have the chance to build something new, I think that's the route we'll take.
Just to back up there, because a lot of people, even those who are familiar with watching drifting, would think that mechanical grip is maybe not that critical. But essentially now with those power levels rising, you really almost have a drag race to that first point where you initiate for the first corner. And that's what you're talking about there, getting that speed to that first corner.
Yeah, the grip game is just after exploding, especially in the last couple of years. In Formula Drift, the majority of cars are pushing like between 900 and 1100 horsepower, and they're actually putting majority of that grip to the ground. As you said, it's a drag race to the first corner, but as soon as you initiate, it's also as fast as you can get through that course while filling all these clips. So grip is a huge important part about it. Tires are very important. Like, everyone is running semi-slicks in sizes between 275 to like 315. So big tire to put on the back of a car that you want to slide around the track.
100%. All right, I think we've got to the bottom of that mechanical grip aspect. So I think we want to just go through the car. And obviously, you're not running the BMW engine. You're running the Toyota 2JZ. Can you tell us why the choice of the 2JZ? Obviously, it's no stranger to drifting anyway, but give us some insight there.
Yeah, for us, the 2JZ is just, you know, amazing at drifting. Super reliable engine, relatively affordable in comparison to like a V8 from the US. And you can just get that power, reliability. And for us personally, my brother builds these engines back in Ireland at Deane Sport, our shop back there. Great experience with the motor, and, you know, drifting and competition is all about reliability as well. So keeping the car on track, we just have experience with this motor. And as it's a new chassis, we have a lot of other things to worry about and try to figure out, but we know the engine's solid.
Now, with the 2JZ in stock form, at least being a 3-litre capacity, you're competing against a lot of cars now with perhaps LS swaps with turbochargers. So when you're looking at an engine that may be in the vicinity of 6 litres versus 3 litres, that's got the potential for a much wider torque curve. How much of an issue is that?
Yeah, so in this car, we're running Nitrous, which really helps with that low-end power. We're actually using it from 3,500 to 7,500. At the start, we started using it just for spool, but Nitrous kind of gets a bit addictive. In the US cars, we're using a direct port 150 shot of Nitrous, and this is quite impressive. And we're using the same way, 3,500 to maybe 8,000. We rev the cars in the US slightly higher, but in general, it gives you a big power band, so we don't really have an issue. You can see the V8 sometimes have a small advantage, like rolling off the line, because they can just slowly roll onto throttle and just, you know, get away without breaking traction, because this when it comes on, it can break quite easily.
That is one of the problems with nitrous. If you've got 150 shot, the instant that nitrous is activated, you've got all of that additional power and torque going through the rear wheel, so traction can potentially be an issue. How are you activating the nitrous? Is it based on throttle position, or what other options have you got there?
Yeah, so for us, we're using on throttle position, over 85% throttle, positive boost pressure, and as I said, between 3.5 to 7.5 or whatever you want. It's very reliable. We've been using it the last few years, and it's just such an easy power adder.
And what sort of power in total are you getting with the engine, both with and without the nitrous?
This motor is about 800 at the engine. Nitrous, it's a 70 shot, so it was spinning on the dyno, but we expect it's giving it probably close to 100 or something in that region. And in the US, it's pretty much the same setup in both cars, but with the 150 shot, it's a lot more aggressive.
Now, that's not really sort of groundbreaking power levels for a 2JZ. We've seen them particularly in drag racing now making well over 2,000 horsepower. Of course, you're trying to hold the engine together for a lot longer. Can you give us a basic rundown of the mechanical specification? What goes into the engine? What parts are you using?
Yeah, so this motor is, we're using a stock Toyota crankshaft. It was actually a brand new block, which is amazing. You can still get the new Toyota blocks. So that's a new block. We're using Zrp rods, they're from Greece. CP pistons, 9.5:1 compression ratio. 1 mil Supertech oversized valves, dual springs, 280 degree BC camshafts. And the head is CNC ported, Hypertune intake and exhaust manifold, and BorgWarner 9180 EFR turbo.
I just wanted to get onto that turbo, but so the engine really is just there to support the power level, and obviously the head's important for the airflow in and out, but really it is that turbocharger that is so critical. So you've got the BorgWarner on there. What sort of boost pressure are you running?
We're using 1.6 bar, so it's relatively safe. We can push it more, but to be honest, you also want to match your power to what you're putting to the ground. So if you're overspinning the tires, sometimes you're losing speed while drifting.
Now, there's a couple of things I want to unpack there. So the first thing is, with the BorgWarner, it's pretty well known they have a critical turbo speed. So you do have to watch the boost pressure. Yeah. Is that an issue for you, or are you nowhere near that maximum safe turbo speed?
At this boost pressure, we're quite safe. We've been using these turbos for the last 3 years and never had a failure. So touch wood on that. They seem very reliable. And very responsive too for the size of it on a 3-liter capacity engine. It's good.
But particularly when you add that nitrous as well. Now, the other aspect you just touched on there was the matching of the power or torque to the available traction. So are you using any aspects there such as gear-dependent boost, or is that not really an issue for drifting?
We're not usually, for me personally. Other teams might do it differently, but I try to rely on my own feeling. Just try to drive the car, know that it's the same every time I get behind the wheel. So we really keep that side of it very simple.
Now, you mentioned the Hypertune plenum there. Can you also tell us what injectors you've got fitted there?
Yeah, we're running Injector Dynamics 1750cc injectors.
Which brings us to the next question. What fuel are you actually running the engine on?
Yeah, Ignite Red 114, so ethanol-based, really, really good stuff.
That's a professional competition-based ethanol blended fuel.
Yeah, blended fuel. Most of the people in Formula Drift are using it, and it's starting to become very popular in Europe too. It's very good, because you'd see with a lot of ethanols that you can have issues with injectors and filters and fuel pumps, but this is really clean, and we've hadn't had an issue in it.
I think the other aspect there as well is with a lot of people who rely on pump E85 is that the ethanol content, they don't really realise, but the ethanol content varies, so that also varies the amount of fuel you require and can end up with reliability problems, particularly on an engine that's near the limit. Right, so I think at this stage we've covered the engine combination pretty well, but getting a reliable drivetrain is just as important as making power in the first place. So what's the gearbox backing the engine?
Yeah, so we're running advanced clutch technology, clutch and flywheel, triple plate, Samsonas 5-speed sequential gearbox, drive shaft shop, prop shaft, Winters quick change differential, which is just the norm now in drifting, and drive shaft shot axles.
And with the Samsona sequential gearbox, with a dog engagement sequential gearbox, obviously there's no need necessarily to use the clutch to change gears. Are you using any flat shift mechanism there, or is that not really a requirement for your use?
I think the flat shift works better with like an electronic throttle body. We're still running the manual cable one, and I just like to keep it as reliable and simple as possible. And another issue you would often see with drifting and flat shift is because if you're getting wheels spinning a straight line, sometimes you have issues with the flat shift.
Moving on to the electronics package controlling it, obviously that's the key to making the whole engine reliable and getting all of the performance out of it. What is the electronics package fitted to the car?
So we're using Ecumaster from front to rear, running two PDMs, PMUs, one for the rear, one for the front. Their dash ADU.
So for those who aren't familiar with that term, can you tell us what is the PMU?
Power management unit. It's really tidy. You get rid of all the switches and relays in the chassis, reduce a lot of the amount of wires that you need to run through it, and it's just simple. What's great about this is you can see what everything is drawing in terms of amps, and you can often catch something. If something is drawing more amps than usual, you can catch it before it might fail. So it's very good for logging and tracking, and it's just tidy.
And then the other aspect that's often overlooked as well is with a conventional fuse and relay setup, if you have a problem and a fuse pops, that's it. You've got to stop. You've got to physically remove and replace the fuse or reset a circuit breaker. Whereas with the power distribution modules like this, solid state switch electronics, you can actually program them to retry certain circuits. So particularly for motorsport where reliability is so key, it gives you a potential chance to get to the finish line where otherwise you may not. Look, Jones, it's been really great to get some insight into the car. Obviously, with your fairly well-known history in drifting, we're likely to see your name on the top of the podium in the future, so we wish you all the best.
Thank you very much. Same to you guys. Myself, my brother and family and friends are big fans of High Performance Academy. Very interesting stuff, and I think you're doing great things for the motorsport world. So.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, guys.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.